welcome in First Lieutenant, Marine First Lieutenant J.J. Constant, who was one of our speakers last night and blew the house away. Blew the house away. It was amazing. J.J., thanks for joining us. Welcome to the program, and thanks for being a part of this weekend. It's been fun, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been great. Thanks for having me on your show.
You know, is there any? I know there's not a lot of stuff you can broadcast. You've been over in the theater, so to speak. But some of the stuff you told us last night was riveting and incredibly compelling. And just give us a feeling for what it's like over there. I mean, we just see news coverage, and we know how slanted that could be because I've been in the media. I know. What's it like over there? If you could give us a slice of what's happening.
It's hot for the most part.
It's hot.
It makes these 82 degree temperatures down here look pretty weak, but. As far as from my perspective as the Marine, we were usually, the units I was involved with were usually in the worst areas, being the Afghan-Pakistan border in Afghanistan and then the Haditha Triad in Iraq. But with my battalion, my unit specifically, we had extremely high morale. We had great leadership from our battalion commander on down through the chain.
And you've got you're part of a book that's coming out. Tell me about that project.
Yeah, there's a book coming out entitled Victory Point. It's being written by Ed Derrick. There's actually a website, victorypoint.info, and that's coming out later this summer. There was a book written by Marcus Luttrell called Lone Survivor, and that book is about a terrible thing that happened in which we sustained the greatest single loss of Special Forces operators since the inception of Special Forces. But this book is about the Marine unit that happened to be mine that went in there and kind of cleared out those guys who had done all that harm to those Navy SEALs and Army Special Forces.
And it is a story of a victory, which is a
exactly.
little different
that's,
for
that,
Hollywood, isn't
that's
it?
That's what I was telling you guys last night. You know, the book, who knows if it'll be a movie or not, but
it will.
The exciting thing is that, you know, I think America needs to realize that it's not all bad. You know, everyone right now, especially in the Marines, I can tell you they're eager to get over there and they're eager to contribute to the cause, especially the global war on terror.
Can you give us a little snippet maybe of one of the stories or something in the book that maybe our listeners could kind of, you know, get some excitement going about this, like, you know, what they could expect?
Sure. They can expect a lot of action. We had to move in order to get to the position to get into the fight. We had to move 6 kilometers, which is about 4-point-something miles, and climb 3,000 feet in elevation.
And with all your gear?
With over 100 pounds of gear.
How many guys?
You had to carry your water bottle. My group, in this case, was 45. We had my platoon of 35 and then 10 attachments because my company commander, to his credit, always challenged or always traveled with us when he felt there would be action. So we did this in 18 hours. It was a pretty unbelievable movement. I mean, these guys were throwing up on the move. Cramping up, just no mercy. We just kept pushing.
And all the while, you're going because one of the insurgent cells, one of the most dangerous cells.
We know one of the insurgent cells is out there, and we're attacking them from 3 different sides, hoping that one of them.
And this is a major
one
cell.
One of them will get them. This is the most active Al Qaeda cell along that region at the time.
And the whole way this went down is you're trying to get 3 different battalions to come in.
Three different basically platoon reinforced.
Okay.
Yeah.
And trying to come in on from all sides, right?
Right. We're trying to force them to fight one of us, and they chose us.
They chose you guys.
And so how did it go down from that point? When you get to the point, are all cramping up and throwing up, and you're almost dehydrated already, and now you got a battle.
Well, fortunately for us, what we think they did was took some time and kind of observed our positions, which gave us the night to sleep, and then they attacked us in the morning. So we were pretty fortunate in that regard. Had they been a little bit smarter, they probably could have done some more harm to us, but their firepower was overwhelming. I always tell people that if my Marines had executed an ambush in that manner, that I'd be impressed with Marines doing it. So these guys were definitely pros and definitely experienced.
So what happened? What can you tell us that happened without spoiling too much of the book?
We won. I mean, these guys attacked us. We brought in our firepower, our jets, our helicopters. We got all the wounded Marines out. Nobody died in this situation, although we had about 9 or 10 wounded when it was all said and done, including myself and my platoon sergeant, Staff Sergeant Crisp. But we got everybody out. We had to walk out because they couldn't send any helicopters in to get us because the threat was too high to get shot down. And we made it out, and we were attacked throughout the entire extraction. It just never ended, it seemed like. We were getting hit at places that, you know, guys who'd been in the area for months had never been hit. We were getting hit everywhere because
just fire coming from all sides.
All directions, everywhere. Schools, buildings, anything.